Yoga Vasistha, Part 22 by Swami Suryadevananda. Salutations to that reality in which all the elements and all the animate and inanimate beings shine as if they have an independent existence, and in which they exist for a time and into which they merge. Salutations to that consciousness which is the source of the apparently distinct threefold divisions of knower, knowledge and known, seer, sight and seen, doer, doing and deed. Salutations to that bliss absolute, the ocean of bliss, which is the life of all beings, whose happiness and unfoldment is derived from the shower of spray from that ocean of bliss. The last time, we discussed the last two of the seven states or planes of wisdom of the great sage Vasistha. Let us review them all briefly before moving on. Shubhicha, or a noble wish. 2. Vicharana, or direct and steady observation of the mind. 3. Tanumanasi, or the thinned and weakened mind. 4. Sattvapatti, or natural turning away from sense pleasure and dwelling in truth. 5. Asamshakti, or natural and total non-attachment or freedom. 6. Padhartha Bhavini, or natural cessation of objectivity. And 7. Turiya, or liberated while living. Today, my friends, let us talk about a small story. Actually, it's a story in a story in the Yoga Vasistha to bring out a point. This is the dreadful elephant in the forest of Saṁsāra. First, let me tell you or share a little bit about this wonderful story. And then we can talk a lot about it. So we'll go over it briefly and then we'll talk about it. There is a dreadful elephant in the forest of Saṁsāra, which is terribly destructive. If this elephant has not been conquered, says Vasistha, there is no hope of self-knowledge. This elephant is desire, and a form is the wish. May I attain this? Or may this happen. It roams in the forest known as the body, and it plays havoc in various ways. Its young ones are the agitated senses, especially the sense of taste. Actions are its tusks. Mental conditioning, its rut. This elephant destroys everyone who is ignorant and conditioned. The entire Saṁsāra is the battlefield in which it operates. Its other names are vasana, or mental conditioning, mind, sankalpa, or concepts and mental images, bhavana, or mental attitude, and thought, and moha, or attachment. Destroy this deadly elephant with the help of the supreme weapon known as courage, persistence, and endurance. As long as this elephant roams in this forest of this body, Saṁsāra, or world appearance, persists. Greetings. Friends, I picked this little story right towards the end of this series together on the Yoga Vasistha. It's actually a story in a story. It's a story used to make a little point. The Yoga Vasistha has 50 main stories to drive home 50 main points that Vasistha tends to do or sets out to do. Stories have a unique way of throwing light on something which dry philosophy would struggle to do so. So let's look into this. The story of the mad elephant is our own story, and the madness is the conditioning that we harbor, though it destroys our peace and prevents the realization of one's true nature. This madness is something that can be let go and should be let go when we clearly see wholeheartedly the destructiveness of it and desire at the same time peace and serenity. This can be let go at any time, not tomorrow, not the day after, but now, here and now. It requires this. It requires clearly seeing its destructive power or its destructiveness and wanting a state of peace and tranquility. These are the conditions to let go of inner conditioning. See, my friends, if you constantly throw pebbles into a placid pond, you will never see the bottom. And this is what we do. We want peace, but we agitate the mind that wants peace. An agitated mind, a fired up mind, can never know peace. Blaming the wind for the ripples that we cause ourselves is vanity. The wind does not cause the ripples, we're the ones stirring it up. Because this pond or this stream is in our own mind, is in our own consciousness. Nobody else can stir this up. We are the keepers of it, and we are the ones who stir it up. Now let us go over some of the main points in this story briefly. The only dread which makes up the samsara is desire. And we might think that we are at a state where we don't have a lot of desires. But whether you call them desires or you call them preference, I would prefer this. I would prefer, and in a simple way, good weather, I would prefer good conditions, I would rather this not happen. All these, whether you call them desires or not, are desires. It is something that you wish which is other than what is present. Desire has wide connotations, including all kinds of hope and hoping in its mildest forms to include every form of preference. Now we have to ask ourselves this. Is this preference necessary to lead a happy and sane life? Why does it have to be? Now this doesn't mean that we simply give up and throw down the gloves and say whatever. Do your very best. But whatever comes, whatever has come, has come. Say you do our best to prepare for a day out and it happens to be a rainy day, it starts raining. Well, the rains have come. There's no point getting upset about it. And you'll say, well, it's only human. But there's an element in us that is beyond human that can look at it and say, okay, it's a rainy day. What can I do and how can I make the most of this day? And if we look at things that way, there's an acceptance, but there's still another spirit that says, what can I do best with this? How can I develop myself, or how can I make the most of what is? When we look at it that way, we don't give room to desire. Because desire, when desire comes in, I wish there was something other than this. There is an immediate loss of happiness because our happiness is associated with something that is not in the present. And so we have taken our happiness and mortgaged it. We have put that happiness into debt. We have disallowed happiness to make it simple. It comes down to this, my friends. What I want or prefer is not happening, and what I don't want is happening. So the don't want disallows happiness. Our wanting and our diswanting or non-wanting or preferring other is what disallows happiness, not what comes. We are pretty quick to blame our happiness or lack of happiness on what comes and what doesn't come, not on who wants and who doesn't want. We never turn the mirror and see that the fault or the problem is not outside, but inside, within ourselves, the way we see things. Isn't this at the heart of all turmoil? Isn't this at the heart of all our inner imbalance? Now, my friends, you have to ask this. Is wanting and rejecting necessary to lead a happy and productive life? Are these two things necessary? Now, we can still do our best. We can still do things that will bring about an impact one way or the other. But are wanting and rejecting, are these two things necessary at all in the equation to move forward towards a better, happier, more productive, and more joyful life? We have to ask ourselves this question. Can we not do our best in every situation as it unfolds and get satisfaction and happiness from doing a job well done rather than from what comes or the conditions that come or both of them? Can we not rewire ourselves to equate happiness and success and joy with effort, because effort is always in our hands? Result and the shape of things may not be, but effort, no one can take effort, the quality of effort, the wholeheartedness of effort, can anyone take that away from you? Can't we equate our happiness with that, because that is what we truly have in our hands at all times, no matter which way the chips may fall? Let come what comes naturally. You need not run after result. When you stop running after result, results start shaping naturally because of the lessons we have learned through this process. Just do everything wholeheartedly and let go. Not let go only after it's done, but learn to let go while doing itself. Can there be a letting go while doing? Doing for the sake of doing is the way to let go of doing while doing. Because there is no I involved. What's in it for me? What would I prefer? That is out of the equation. And the only way that can get out of the equation is to do things because it needs to be done, on their own merit, when it needs to be done, naturally. Now, this doesn't mean that we don't plan ahead and we don't do things, but it is different from doing what needs to be done and the result, or what one can expect, or the conditions one would prefer. Those are different. There's a subtle difference between these, and we have to see that carefully. This is what cuts desire at the root. It starts in its mildest forms, my friends, as preference. And preference is always related to outcome, to conditions, or to things that are out there, and never to things that are in here. Effort is always related to the inner equation, especially when you do what needs to be done because it needs to be done. So, my friends, it really comes down to this. Why is it necessary to agitate the mind if we want peace? Is it necessary at all? Can we not find a way to live and to function and to do what needs to be done in any and all conditions without agitating the mind? Is this possible? Can we find a way to do this? So it all comes down to this little word called outcome. Instead of wanting outcome that comes, why can we not do things on their own merit? Action on its own merit. Inner agitation leads to outer agitation, and then outer agitation gives more inner agitation. This, my friends, forms a vicious circle that feeds on itself. The inner agitation is first a wanting. The outer agitation is the shape things take. And then that outer agitation of things not going our way, or wanting more of things to go our way, creates more inner agitation. And this cycle feeds on itself, causing endless turmoil. We can break the cycle at any time But we have to want to break the cycle, to clearly see the destructiveness of the cycle, like the mad elephant that we are talking about. We set this elephant into fury, and then we try to bring calm to it. Unless we deal with that elephant first, which is desire in all its forms, we're not going to put an end to this. Agitation increases conditioning, and it makes meditation difficult or impossible. It even destroys the simple joys that come along naturally in life. But the key at the heart of all this is it destroys peace. Meditation requires a peaceful mind. The mind is already stirred up. We don't need to stir it up any further. And if we do, we are never going to see through it to its source, which is ultimately what meditation seeks to do. So we have to make this very fundamental choice. How do we want to live? How do we want to live? Do we value peace, or do we wish to continue agitation because of the little trinkets that it might bring, trying to stay ahead of others, competition, all of that stuff? What do we value most of all? Is our inner peace, calm, and tranquility something that we can brush off and trade off for little shiny things that may come? Is this worth it at all? A meaningful spiritual life is not possible if there is agitation within. It is just not possible. Spiritual life will always be relegated to doing what is called religious activity, to doing things. But doing is very different from being. The whole focus on spiritual life is to go from meaningful doing to discovering being, or who we are. So doing becomes a sort of springboard. We push on that to be able to discover our true nature, to be able to see our true nature. We have to do in such a way that it does not add to the distortion, but it allows us to see our true nature. That is the only purpose of being. A springboard to being, or who we are. Inner peace can lead to a wonderful spiritual harvest this way. There are some major agitators that we have to avoid. Vasistha has a short list of them. Let's review them. 1. Vasana, or mental conditioning. And what are these? All the notions that we have gathered in our mind. So we have to not use our notions and live without using our notions. And this is possible by directly engaging every situation consciously as it happens, real time, lifetime. Not allowing memory and not allowing conditioning to come into play. Not by denying it, not by suppressing it, but instead by engaging the inner intelligence, which is aware of what is, as it happens, real time, lifetime. 2. Sankalpa, or concepts and mental images. Each time we revisit an image and certain notions about the image, the notions fuse with the image. The image is a sort of outline, a picture, an image of what is, but the image increases its intensity or gains intensity by the value we add about it. How do we feel about those notions? When that how do we feel gets fused with the image itself, it is called sankalpa, or concepts. It is an image plus a way we feel about the image, and that is what a concept or sankalpa is. 3. Moha, or attachment. Now this includes infatuation of every kind, positive and negative actually. The stronger the notions that we entertain, and remember what we spoke about when we spoke about concepts earlier, it is an image plus how we feel about it. Now, the stronger the notion that we entertain, the more we are infatuated or attached or feel repulsed by, not to the object, but to the notion of the object. The object becomes secondary to the notion that we have or the feeling that we have about it. 5. Bhavana, or mental attitude and feeling. Now, all of these things we're talking about, my friends, they may seem slightly similar, but the ancient sages have used these words to point to different stages in the evolution of conditioning and its impact on us and how we can deal with this. So bear with me and work with me through all this. Bhavana, or mental attitude and feeling. Repeated visiting all these images and entertaining the notions we have about them. There are notions that are infused in them. Once again, harboring those notions in our heart, excuse me, while we revisit those notions, it makes it very difficult to separate notions from how we feel about them. They all fuse together and they form what's called a mental attitude about them. And this mental attitude that we have about things is bhavana. So in bhavana, we even stop looking at notions. We are completely looking at our feeling about those notions. The notions become an excuse to harbor the feelings that we have about them. And the last one that we'll have here is the mind itself. The mind is not only a receptacle of all the notions, but has energy on which it acts. So it has the energy on which it acts or on which it reacts to the notion. And just look at this. It's all happening within the mind itself. The mind harbors the notion. It harbors the feeling of the notion. And then it reacts to the notions. The mind destroys itself. And this was why Vasistha uses the analogy of a mad elephant in this forest of Saṁsāra. Because a mad elephant is unpredictable and its ways can be destructive. This mind, my friends, seemingly intelligent, is not able to comprehend anything. Not the mind, but the mind that has concepts, notions, images, and that reacts without being able to understand what is going on to all this. That is the mind. The conditioned mind is the mind that we are talking about. The conditioned mind, Vasistha says. And this is at the root of what destroys all our peace. This is not able to comprehend anything really, though it seems intelligent and acts intelligent. This mind borrows light from the inner intelligence. And when the mind is watched without remission or without break, it is weakened. When it is not used, it is weakened by disuse. So watching it and not using it and using the inner intelligence, which is aware of it and its mischief, instead, as it happens, real time, lifetime, nonstop. This is what weakens the mind. It weakens by disuse. It has gained strength by use, and it weakens by disuse. So unrelenting vigilance renders the mind powerless over time. So in a few short verses of this story, Vasistha has really gone to the heart of the matter, and he has outlined the root cause of all of our problems. All our problems come from this. This mad elephant, which is a mind that has become unruly and destructive to its own self. It all comes down to this, my friends, an out of control mind which acts on the basis of unexamined notions and convictions that we have held closely in our heart for too long. As long as this elephant roams the forest of the body, samsara, or world appearance, persists in our lives, and our lives will be chaotic at best. a struggle, and we will miss the purpose of life, which is to know our true nature. See, my friends, all that we do in action is in time process. You do it now, and a little bit later, you did it earlier, and tomorrow, you did it yesterday. It's all in time process. But if doing can lead to the discovery of being, being, existence is not in time process. Existence does not come into being, and existence cannot go out of being. So, doing can be a window and a tool to being. It can be a means to discover who we are, but we have to do this expertly. In the Bhagavad Gita, in one of the verses, Krishna says something to this effect, that yoga is expertness in action. Expertness, skill in action. Yoga karma sukha oshalam. So we have to live our lives excellently, because that verse from the Gita applies very clearly over here. Action is in time process, but it provides a window and an opportunity to discover our true nature or to discover eternity. Action can be a springboard, though in time process, to leap beyond it into eternity if lived carefully, if lived expertly. So the great sage advises us to destroy this deadly elephant with the help of the supreme weapon of courage, persistence, and endurance for our highest good. A couple thoughts in closing, my friends. As long as this elephant roams in the forest of this body, samsara, or world appearance, persists. We are not here to do this and that, but to, through doing, to restore our feeling of being to its natural state. Next time, we conclude this series with a focus on these 5 points. What liberated sages conclude, attitudes conducive to liberation, overcoming samsara and therefore some sorrow, a noble person, and Vasistha's concluding instructions. Friends, thank you for joining me today. To download this video, its audio, or PDF transcript, kindly visit suryadevananda.org. Thank you.